everyone. I'm Crazy Aunt Lindsey, and you are in a very special live stream event of the Fab Lab Digital Daycare. This is our first time ever doing a live stream. So if you were just over at YouTube, we're so sorry. And thank you so much for joining us here on Facebook. We're gonna be doing our best to see if we can work out the technical issues with YouTube. But as we all know, many of us are stuck at home doing our work from home, and that includes creatives who rely on YouTube, just like me. So we're gonna give YouTube some time to work it out, and we're gonna pick up where we left off. I will start all over again, so don't you worry. But before we get started, I have to send a very special thank you shout out to our awesome sponsors who have made this live broadcast for the next 2 to 3 weeks possible. First and foremost, Autodesk. Thank you so much for moving so quickly to help the Fab Lab and my collaborator, Mbajika, have everything that we need to get this content to you so that your families will have 2 to 3 to 4 hours of awesome time to either hang out on their own or together and have a wonderful time. I also must send a very special thank you to Portland local female founded and led businesses, Living Room Realty, who has made us right at home here in our very own studio, as well as our media partner, Rain, the Growth Agency. Thank you both so much for making sure that we're empowered to make sure that we can bring all of this to the families that are at home doing their best to, well, be at home for this indefinite period of time. Okay, guys, we had already started with a project on YouTube, but because we were having technical issues, I made it through the first couple of steps first, and I was kind of teasing you guys with what we're going to make. So I'm gonna tease you again. What do you think we're making? So I had 3 very important ingredients: flour, cream of tartar, and salt, which is already in this bowl. And before we guess what it is that we're going to be doing, what is the thing that we have to do? Wash our hands. So I'm going to hop over to my Fab Lab sink and wash my hands. And because I've been waiting for about, I don't know, maybe like half an hour to an hour, I'm gonna wash my hands really thoroughly again. So as you know, many of us have had to relearn how to wash our hands. I for sure did. It used to be that all I would do is rinse my hands, scrub them really good, turn them off, and then go. I was guilty of it. But now what we have to do is wash our hands for a minimum of 20 to 30 seconds with soap so that we're making sure we're not picking up and moving around too many germs and viruses that want to get into our bodies and give us a hard time. So I'm going to turn my water on, and my water is nice and warm. I'm going to give myself a pump. I'm going to turn my water off because we're still conserving water. And I'm going to rub my hands together very vigorously. And I'm gonna rub the backs of my hand individually. And I'm gonna get in between all of my fingers. I'm gonna rub in between my fingers, these little valleys. Are you guys washing your hands too? If you're washing your hands, I want your parents to send me a tweet or a comment in the Facebook session. We're washing our hands. And if you're not, that's okay. But as long as you're not too close to anybody. So I'm going to rub my wrists, all the way down to my wrists. I'm gonna rub vigorously again here. And this should be about 20 to 25 seconds. Okay, so I'm gonna get my nails really good, my cuticles. Awesome. And now I'm ready to rinse. Okay, so rinse, rinse, rinse. I'm gonna give it a good shake. And hey, guess what? I had a friend make a very special song just for you and me, and I'm gonna share that song with you a little bit later, and it'll help you wash your hands for the right amount of time. Okay, so stay tuned for that. That'll come a little later in the show. Okay, so we're all set washing our hands. Roll my sleeves up a bit. And like I said, I'm here back with my, flour, my salt, and my cream of tartar. Now, does anybody know what those 3 main things come together to be? If you guys said bread, yes-ish, but not quite, not in this Fab Lab recipe. You'll see in just a second. So I have my flour and my salt, all of my dry ingredients, my flour and my salt, And then I put in some cream of tartar. And the cream of tartar is really, really good to keep this particular project nice and soft. So what do we need to stay nice and soft and last longer? Do you guys have any ideas yet? So I'm gonna mix my dry ingredients. And actually, because it's been kind of hard for me to get to the grocery store as often as I like lately, I don't know if your family is dealing with this, but getting to the grocery store is a little bit tougher. Sometimes there aren't all the ingredients that I'm looking for. There's one thing that's missing that I wasn't able to find, and that's oil, but that's okay. We're gonna wing it with this project. Okay, so we've got the dry ingredients in, and the next thing I'm going to do is I'm going to add some hot water. Now, you can boil your water, but I have a little spigot over here that I can just get hot water from. If you're going to boil your water for this project, make sure you have adult supervision. So I'm going to head over to the sink, and I'm going to get some nice hot water. And before I add my hot water, actually, I'm just going to dump it in. That's 1 cup. I'm going to start with 1 cup, and I'm going to mix it. Let's see here. A little oil would really make this project a little bit better, but that's okay. I'm going to get a little bit more water. Just a bit. Can you guys tell what I'm making yet? Oh well. Sometimes the Fab Lab gets a little messy. Okay. Okay. And I'm just gonna mix and mix and mix. Add a little more water. Can you kind of see what's coming together just yet? If anyone has commented Play-Doh, they are correct. This is one of my favorite recipes in the whole world, the Fab Lab Play-Doh recipe. Now's a good time to, oh, you know what, it's a little bit, if yours is too wet, mine is a little bit too wet, so I'm gonna add a little extra flour to mine. This is probably about a half a cup. And I'm just gonna play with it. Oh, it's so soft. Oh my gosh, this is so, so, so soft. It feels so wonderful in my hands. And because I'm gonna do something special with this project in a little bit, I'm going to add some food coloring, but I'm gonna add several different colors. Now, this is a great substitute, a wonderful option actually. If you can't get to a store to get, you know, like your normal toys and like things like that, you can make toys on your own at home. And that's what the Fab Lab is all about. We just use what we have to make what we can, right? So this is coming together so beautifully. And again, normally this recipe would have a little bit of oil, about 2 tablespoons of oil. And I'll have, if your parents aren't already signed up to the Fab Lab Digital Daycare daily newsletter, make sure you head over to thefablab.com and sign up for that so you can get a full rundown of the resources, recipes, and ingredients that you need for the day's projects. So look at this. This is just a giant ball of Play-Doh. I'm gonna set my bowl aside, and then I'm gonna add a few things to my Play-Doh, okay? Now, we're gonna do something special with a very special friend shortly. And we're gonna need a couple of different colors. So I'm gonna add some food coloring. I'm gonna separate this out, and I'm gonna make a couple different colors of Play-Doh. And if I run out, I actually might make a little bit more Play-Doh in a moment. But first, because Play-Doh, the kind you get buy at the store, or the kind that you make at home, Play-Doh can totally hold onto all kinds of yucky germs. That's why we washed our hands before we started. But all kinds of yucky germs can get stuck in our hands and then stuck in our sticky Play-Doh. Now, it's not sticking to our hands, but the germs can get stuck in the Play-Doh. So I want to give my Play-Doh a little extra antibacterial boost. So all way back in the day, I found out about this amazing essential oil called tea tree oil. It's antiseptic. And so I'm going to add it. It smells really sort of, what's the word? Almost like mentholated. So I'm going to add just a drop or two to each of my doughs. And then I'm going to knead it in with my food coloring. So the tea tree oil is going to help it be a little antibacterial. Now I'm going to add some green to one of my dough balls. Green is a good color. I love this. And I'm just going to knead it in my hand. And actually, I mentioned to you guys that I was going to have a really special friend come and join us. And I think I'm going to have him come and help me mix up my dough and talk to us a little bit about who he is and what he does while we make fun colors of Play-Doh. Do you want to meet him? You guys want to meet him? Awesome. I am so excited for you to meet my very, very, very special friend, Dr. Ken Stedman. And because we're going to practice social distancing, I'm going to step to the side. Hi, Dr. Ken.
Hi,
how are you?
Good. What do I need to do right now?
You tell me.
What do you think?
Wash our hands.
Wash our hands. Exactly. We're going to do that. We're going to do it nice and long.
Awesome.
We'll do our good.
Now, Dr. Ken Stedman is a very special kind of doctor. He's a PhD. He studies viruses, and that means he's a virologist. He's based here in Portland, Oregon at Portland State University. I've actually met him many years ago. He's one of my favorite people, and he helps me understand all kinds of crazy things when it comes to germs and viruses and bacteria, and he's going to share a little bit of that with you too. But you also do something else special. Tell me about what some of the other things that you do as a virologist.
So I also try and communicate my science. So I've been working quite a lot with OMSI,
awesome.
Museum of Science and Industry, which is unfortunately closed right now. But as soon as possible, we're going to try and get it open. But we're also trying to do some virtual stuff as well.
Awesome.
And so I'm going to be probably doing a science pub here. And this kind of science pub, I think, you know, just for the parents, of course. you can go online and everyone will have their own beer. And so you can just, you know, so watch along and do your own thing.
Yeah, awesome.
And so we'll do that. And then I also, you know, bring all of my little virus friends with me whenever I go to OMSI.
Mm-hmm.
And we just talk about how amazing viruses are. Yeah, there's some viruses that make you sick, yeah, but there are also a lot of viruses that don't make you sick, and they're just really amazing things. And so I kind of call myself a bit of a virus evangelist.
Also known as the virus hunter.
just because I'm just so excited about viruses, and I'm so excited today to be talking to all of you about viruses, and I'm trying to give you a little bit of an idea how viruses work, and you may be wondering, like, what the heck the Play-Doh and viruses have to do with each other.
I think we're going to find out.
That's what we're going to try and do.
So I'm going to make a little pink one here. Oh, this is a good gel.
Oh,
yeah,
that's going to be a really awesome color.
I think so.
I'm so psyched about that. This is going to be great.
Yeah, I'm super excited. So guys, just to recap while Dr. Ken gets himself situated, we made Play-Doh, because it's going to be really salty if you try to eat it. Don't put it in your mouth. But we made Fab Lab Play-Doh, which interestingly is one of the first projects that we ever did in the Fab Lab together. So we just made a really quick recipe of Play-Doh that you can make right now if you have Play-Doh. Sorry, we're just practicing social distancing. Mm-hmm. But if you have flour at home, you can do this project. If you have salt at home, you can do this project. If you have a little bit of vegetable oil, that will make this project awesome. We actually left our vegetable, we didn't have access to vegetable oil because there weren't any in the shelves nearby, but it seems to be a little bit optional, so it's not that bad. But you can make Play-Doh right now at home with a half a cup of salt, a full cup of flour, some hot boiling water with parental supervision and food coloring if you want to have fun with colors. And we put essential oils in it to make it a little antibacterial, but you can also use it, put essential oils in it to make it smell pretty. Use lavender, I've done that a bunch of times, give it away as gifts, but this is just what we're doing for today. Oh, your hands are so colorful.
My hands like a great color. I think all the colors are actually merely going onto my hands, yeah. Going on the Play-Doh.
But that's fine.
You were supposed to fold it in, Dr. Ken. I should have shown you better.
I do viruses. I don't do Play-Doh.
Okay, I'm the Play-Doh expert. You're the virus expert.
Exactly.
You're
right. We all have to be experts at something. That's the point, right?
I'd love to know what you guys are an expert at. Okay,
yeah,
so I'm pretty okay with my greenish colored Play-Doh, so I'm going to put that here for right now. I'm going to work on this one.
Yeah. I'm not sure. Like, let's just stipulate this is your pinkish, but let me show you some of my other virus models that I brought with me.
I would love to see them.
And I can share this with all of the kids out there and their parents too.
Awesome.
So what I brought are a bunch of some of the viruses that I work with, mm-hmm. but also some of the viruses that other people look at. Mm-hmm. And so we can take a look at some of these guys here. This one is one of my favorites. This actually is a virus that I've been working on for over 20 years.
It looks like a
really long
time. It looks like a pineapple.
Like a pineapple or kind of a football or something like that. But what's really weird about this particular kind of virus, it loves really, really, really hot, really acidic conditions. You go to hot springs in Yellowstone and Iceland, all these places where you have like crazy hot water.
Yeah.
And these viruses are there. How they can survive under those conditions is just really amazing. They don't make us sick. What they do is they actually make the microbes sick that live in the hot springs. And so that's why I'm
so
really interested in
microbes can get sick. Can you tell me about what a microbe is and how a microbe gets sick?
So there are bacteria, like you're talking about, mm-hmm. essential oils help
yeah.
out with not getting bacteria. And
yeah.
sometimes bacteria can, oh, we're getting too close to each other, too close to each other. We gotta stay apart.
Social distancing, if you are too close to your brother, if you can hit your brother right now, you're too close.
Families are okay, but once you're outside of it, that's
okay.
A bit. Families are okay.
Oh, awesome.
But we want to say that I actually don't like the social distancing thing because
really?
I like physical distance. Well, I don't like physical distance.
You
but
like the term
I like the
distance,
term physical distance,
okay.
much better than because you don't want to be socially distant from people. You want to be physically different from people, but
right.
still be able to communicate with them. Now
mm-hmm.
we're staying physically
yeah.
separated from each
awesome.
Other, but we're still actually having these kind of social interactions.
Yes, very important.
So, but you asked me a question about microbes.
Yes, microbes.
So what are microbes? Microbes are really tiny organisms, and they're things that are alive. And usually people think about this like bacteria.
Mm-hmm.
And bacteria can make you sick.
Bacteria is a microbe.
Bacteria is a microbe, but also bacteria are really important for us. You may have heard about the microbiome or in your yogurt. Yogurt has lots of bacteria in it.
Is that like probiotics?
Yeah, some of the probiotics are also these kinds of bacteria.
Awesome.
So we actually live together with bacteria and we live together with viruses. And so
we live together with bacteria and viruses, Dr. Ken.
We do. Yes.
I need
They're
to hear so much
part
more
of
about
us.
This. They're a part of me?
They're part of you.
Are they part of you?
They're part of me too.
Okay, okay, okay.
We've got different microbes that are associated with us.
Okay.
But we also have more microbes in us than we have cells of us, which is just crazy.
Because aren't there like trillions of cells inside of us?
We have trillions of our own cells, but there are also trillions of the microbes that are inside us.
Wow.
And some of those microbes also have viruses. Now, you may ask me, and I'll bet you're just about to.
I'm certain I was.
What is a microbe? And why do you call it a microbe?
Yeah.
Why do you think you might call it a microbe?
Because it's micro,
well,
and it wears a and it wears a robe.
So, what is this microbe? What do you mean by micro? What do you mean by micro?
Micro, like really tiny.
Really tiny.
Like really small.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And what would you need to see something that's really small?
A microscope?
Exactly.
Okay, cool.
So microbes are something you need a microscope to be able to see.
Wow. Okay.
And that's because they're really small.
Okay.
And so that's really the whole idea, is that you're using the microscope to actually see these things. Now, the smaller something is, the bigger the microscope is you actually need to see it.
Wow. Why?
So one of the things that we do, and this is at Portland State, but just in general, mm-hmm. We try and look at these viruses, like this guy.
Wow. So how many times bigger is this virus model than the actual virus?
The real thing? Well, this one is actually about 7 million times. That's a really big number.
7 million?
Bigger than the real thing.
Wow.
And so you may notice I brought some other virus models with me.
Oh,
here.
Yeah, very cool.
And this one might actually look kind of similar to that one. Oh, it lost its base here. So these guys probably look pretty similar to each other, right?
Yeah, they do look super similar.
So this one is actually a million times life size.
Wow.
So I find it actually really hard to think about what a million is.
So wait a minute, just to be clear, you're telling me that this is a million times bigger than what's actually in real life?
Yes. A million times bigger.
So a real microbe is a million times smaller than that.
Okay, the real virus is a million times smaller.
Wow.
The actual microbes, like a bacteria, it's not quite the same as a bacteria, but it's really similar, is actually a lot bigger than this.
Mm-hmm.
It's probably about this size.
Wow.
But still, really, really small.
Mm-hmm.
And if you think about, you know, a million times life size, just think. It's just so bizarre to think about.
I'm trying to think, like, from here to Mexico is how far?
So from here to Mexico is about 1,000 kilometers.
Okay.
Actually, a little beyond that, maybe about 1,500 kilometers.
Okay.
But from here to Mexico, that's a really long way, right?
Yeah, that's a really
long way. You get in a plane, how long does it take you to get to Mexico?
Oh my gosh, depending upon where.
Yeah.
Six or so hours.
A whole bunch of hours in a plane going really, really fast. Well, if you, crazy Aunt Lindsay, were a million times bigger than you are now,
okay.
How big would you be?
How big would I be? I'd be very big.
Right, but how big?
So big?
So big?
You tell me, I don't know.
Well, I'm betting that if you were a million times bigger than you are now,
yeah.
If you were to lay down with your feet right here in Portland, Oregon,
yeah.
Where would your head be?
I bet it'd be in Mexico.
It'd be in Mexico. Exactly.
Yeah, cool.
So it's so amazing.
That is amazing.
So and think another thing, that's how big you would be if you were a million times as big as you are now.
Mm-hmm.
Now think if you were shrinking down that million times, you would be tiny, 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 tiny.
Like the size of an ant.
And that's what you end up with, something like this.
Wow.
Which is being like a million times bigger than its actual life size.
Yeah.
So that's giving a bit of an idea on the viruses and how big they are. One thing you might notice is I've got a whole bunch of different kinds of viruses here. You see they have different shapes.
I want to touch them. I'm just going to rinse my hands first.
Rinse
you can
your
see
hands,
all my,
exactly.
I'll
wash them
back.
Off. Wash them off.
But I'd love for you to tell us about your microbes.
So these particular viruses are really interesting. And they have all these different shapes. I already showed you this one that kind of looks like, I don't know, a football or what you called them, a lemon shape originally. But there also are these viruses that look like this. This is kind of like a lunar lander virus. This one is actually really interesting because it infects those bacteria like you find in us.
Mm-hmm.
And this particular one is what they call a bacteriophage. For all the parents out there, you can go and look it up. What it means is eats bacteria. And it's really nice because what happens with these viruses, if you actually have a bad bacteria that's infected you, you can use some of these viruses to actually kill off that bad bacteria.
Mm-hmm.
So a really potentially cool way of thinking about good viruses.
Yeah.
So I've got a bunch of other ones. You know what this one is, Aunt Lindsay?
I can't wait to see. I can't imagine.
So a virus that nobody had heard of until a couple of years ago.
Corona?
No, this is not a coronavirus. That's another one.
Another virus.
Another virus.
Well, we heard of the influenza virus since like 1918.
But what was the virus everybody was talking about and then I totally forgot about?
H1N1? You're going to have to tell me.
Zika virus.
Oh, Zika!
Exactly.
Oh my god!
But this is a model of Zika virus. million times life size.
Wow. So, I kind of want to make a model of it with my Play-Doh.
Yeah. Well, you might want to make a model with your Play-Doh, but that's actually one of the things that we made this Play-Doh for.
Yes.
Is we really want to think about how viruses work. And so what I wanted to do was do a little show and tell for all of us out here, and in fact, hopefully at least as much for the parents as for the kids, how viruses work, and let's think about them.
I love
it. I told you already, again, these things are really, really tiny.
Yeah.
So we're gonna have to make something really big.
Okay.
And then you also probably heard that viruses have to infect something.
Yes.
In order to be able to survive and make more viruses.
Mm-hmm.
So what we need is we need a cell.
Okay.
And we need some viruses.
Can this be a cell?
That's actually looked a little small for a cell. Why don't we take this guy as being a cell?
Great.
And let's move our other viruses out of the way here for just a sec. And then, so
don't
this
mind all this
cell.
Mess. Don't mind all that mess.
It's science. Oh. It's messy in my lab too. Trust me. So we'll call this a cell.
Mm-hmm.
And then what we do is we make a little virus. So here's our virus.
Mm-hmm.
Now, what do you think about this virus relative to this cell? What do you think? There's a problem here. There's a really big problem here. What's
well,
the problem?
They're two different things. They're not together.
They're not together, right?
Mm-hmm.
But what else? Got different colors.
Yeah, different colors.
But it's actually important to keep them apart from each other, but normally they're pretty similar.
Mm-hmm.
So, but what did I tell you about the viruses before? What do you remember about viruses?
That they can't live on their own.
But what other thing? What were we talking about you being in Mexico for?
Oh, because they're really, really small.
They're really tiny. So,
yeah.
This is way too big. So actually, relative to our cell, the virus would be about this big, which is really, really tiny.
Just come into frame just a little bit so we can see the difference between
What's
the two.
The difference between these
and,
two
and hold them
is
up.
Really, really
so
huge.
This is a cell.
Yep.
And this
would be the virus.
Is a virus.
And that's actually a pretty big virus.
That's so different.
So, they're really tiny. Now,
we're
not going to do this for our little model because it would be really hard to see. So we'll stick with the bigger ones here. So now we've got our cell and we got our virus.
Cool.
And what happens is this virus comes along and it finds a cell and it fuses into it.
Ah!
And that's what happens with viruses, is they end up being fused together.
Okay.
And then what happens is this virus starts to make more virus.
How does it make more viruses?
It makes more viruses. We're just going to start by looking here, and that makes a whole bunch more of these viruses. Mm-hmm. We end up with lots more of these viruses, right? And then what happens is that this cell actually falls apart because it's been making all of these viruses. Now, what I think we should let's actually look on the inside of what's going on.
I'd love to look inside.
With these viruses.
Should we get a butter knife?
Cells. Oh, we could get a butter knife or hand cuts like a knife. What do you think?
Yeah, sure.
So we've got our cell right here, and we're going to cut it in half. Up. There's our cell cut in half
nice
and doughy. Very well done, by the way, on making Play-Doh.
Without oil. The oil will help just keep it together. This is such a good recipe, by the way.
Right. And inside this cell, we got a couple things.
Okay.
One thing, we got a little extra yarn.
I'm just going to move it. I'm going to
move
it
over
right
here.
Into
in the middle here.
Yeah, right
good.
Here. Right about here is good.
And inside this cell, we've got something which we call DNA.
DNA?
DNA.
Is it like the lines?
The double helix that wraps around each other.
Okay.
That's the instructions for the cell.
And I heard that that was actually called something really fun.
Oh, yeah. Well, some people also call it what they call the
genome.
The genome. Yeah.
In my mind, it's a little hip hop genome. He's got a dark gnome with chains. I'm going to have to get a Fab Lab genome.
You do need a Fab Lab genome, I think. Yes.
Okay.
But this is the genome of the cell that we have right here.
Okay.
So with this genome, that's what the cell used to make more of itself.
Okay.
Now we got our virus, right?
Yeah.
So what's inside this virus? We can open this one up and take a look inside the virus.
Mm-hmm.
And it turns out that inside that virus, there's also a genome, but it's different.
It's a different genome.
And it's a little hard to see here. Let's
That's
see if
okay.
we can grab another one. Okay, so actually we've got the little virus genome here, which is the different color. And this virus genome. And so if he closes up, and that's what these normally look like. See, big okay. cell, mm-hmm. the genome's hiding on the inside.
Right. So and the viral genome is hiding inside.
It's hiding inside.
Yeah. Then and genomes already live in cells, but this is a virus genome.
This one's got a virus genome. And you notice it's a little bit different. And the color is a little bit different. Yeah. And that's because actually this virus genome, like many virus genomes, mm-hmm. is made out of RNA, not out of DNA.
Oh.
Which makes it a little bit different. And maybe the Fab Lab, we can talk about the difference some other time.
Yeah, for sure.
But for today, we'll just call it a little bit different.
Awesome.
So what happens is, when these two guys fuse with each other,
yep.
what happens is, we're going to take this off, is that that little virus genome gets inside the cell. You remember?
Oh, yes.
They squish together?
Yep. I don't know if you guys can see it, but we have a little, so here's like some gray, this is actually yarn. We're using yarn to demonstrate. So this is some like nice white and gray. And then here's a little piece of pink. We don't know if you, hopefully you can see it, but there's two different yarns in here, two different colors. So here it is.
Right.
And so this is our, these are our genomes. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So we've got now the cell's genome
mm-hmm.
and the virus's genome.
Mm-hmm.
Now remember, this is just fused together like right here.
Right, right.
Mm-hmm. So,
and this is how this genome, so this
right.
virus so cell is how this virus genome got inside.
Squished, and then it let its genome out on the inside.
Got it.
Then what happens is, so we said the genome's not the, you know, guy with the big chain.
Not the garden gnome with the
not
gold
the
chains.
The garden gnome with the gold chains.
Got it.
But what
an
this is.
An instruction manual.
It's an instruction manual. And so this gray-green part, that's the instruction manual for the cell. What do you think this pink one is?
It's for the virus.
It's the instruction manual for the virus.
Got it.
Exactly.
Cool.
And what the really cool thing about viruses are, is that instruction manual says, hey, we can use this to do what? What do you think that instruction manual is?
Make more?
Make more.
Viruses?
Not just the viruses, but what else?
I don't know.
Maybe it needs to make more of the instruction manual.
More like a printing press.
So what happens is you end up with a lot more copies of...
Oh my gosh.
The virus's instructions.
So I'd love for you to get an overhead shot of this. I would love for you to see it. Unless we're already screen and screen. That's so cool.
So this virus instruction manual.
Yeah.
First thing that it does is it makes more instructions.
So this one genome turned into all of these other
turns
genomes.
All those other genomes.
And that's what happens when a virus gets inside of a
virus. Virus infects a cell. Is it makes a whole bunch more copies of
wow.
its instructions.
Wow. I'd love to have a pen nearby so I can write down exactly what I'm gonna grab a pen so that we can write that down. Go ahead, keep going.
Right, and so that's the first thing that happens is mm-hmm. you make more copies of the instructions.
Mm-hmm.
But the instructions, what was the virus? What's the virus?
The virus was just a carrier.
Right, but which of our colors here that we had, what would those colors actually be? Which color is the one that has the virus?
The green one.
Yeah, the green one. So what we need to do is somehow you've got to get those instructions into the green thing. And so what happens when you make a whole bunch more of them is you have those instructions
mm-hmm.
which say, let's make more of the viruses and put those instructions into the virus itself.
Mm-hmm.
So, why don't you grab some green stuff and some instructions? I'll grab some green stuff and instructions, and
we'll make more?
A bunch of viruses.
Okay, cool. I love it.
So, get some instructions, put it inside the virus. So now we've got another virus.
So are we making viruses right now? Am I making healthy cells or
so
are we making viruses?
So we're making viruses, but that's a really good point. Now, where do you think all the green stuff comes from?
I bet it comes from sometimes the air, sometimes surfaces.
Well, actually, it's mostly coming from the healthy cell.
Oh, because it became
the
printing press for the genomes.
The printing press is making the genomes, but it's also providing all the material for the new viruses.
Oh, so this one cell because of the one genome, made the healthy cell produce more viruses with the sickness genome inside of it?
With the virus genome inside them. So what do you think this does to the cell?
It makes, it's not good news.
It's not good news for the cell. It's really not good news for the cell. And so that's actually exactly how these viruses are working.
Really?
Is they come in, they bring their instructions, and then those instructions end up making more of the virus.
Oh, and it breaks it.
Taking stuff away from the cell.
Wow, so it's almost like the healthy cell becomes its own illness.
To some extent, what's it's being used by the virus as a way to make more virus.
Wow, and this is happening inside of just our bodies, or does it happen in other places?
So this happens, as I mentioned before, when we look at these guys. These guys will infect cells that are the bacteria, the microbes.
You know, wow.
This would be like one of our cells. But you can also have these that are infecting microbes as well. Pretty much every kind of living thing has viruses that are associated with it.
Wow.
So all of them have something like this.
Now, what happens to the healthy DNA?
So what happens to the healthy DNA is that healthy DNA actually usually just ends up being left inside the cell. When the cell gets really unhappy, like this one is here, really, I think pretty obviously a very unhappy
cell. I mean, it is like not doing great.
It actually ends up completely falling apart.
Oh, wow.
And it's something called apoptosis.
Apoptosis? I think apoptosis is going to be our Fab Lab vocab word of the day.
That's
officially
a really vocab word. Apoptosis. And so it's basically like the cell committing suicide.
Wow.
It says, I'm going to fall apart. Because what happens when it falls apart?
Self-destructing?
It's self-destructing. But if you self-destruct, what does that mean about a virus? It's going to try and make more virus.
That mean it stops making more viruses?
It can't make any more viruses because the cell has said,
So our cells are sometimes or usually smart enough to know when it's under attack?
Sometimes they are. So they actually know that we've got these things that are under attack and can be under these kinds of conditions.
That's amazing. Wow.
Yeah. So we've got an apoptotic cell here. And
can
a whole bunch of, I can write this
can
out
spell
for you.
Apoptotic, this is, like right
this
here.
Is going to be the vocab, right? So, and I'm probably going to misspell it, but you better make sure you're far enough away from me here.
You're going to see this word later on today for sure. Apoptosis.
Apoptosis.
Wow. This is so awesome. Dr. Ken, this is great. Thank you so much for showing us how to turn our DIY homemade antibacterial Play-Doh into a virus-making factory, basically, and helping us learn more about our cells that are in our bodies. I'm so excited that you came with us, and I hope that you'll come back.
Oh, I'm planning on,
onto the live stream or into an actual episode.
Of the Fab Lab.
Thank you so much for joining us. Would you like to share any more information with us? How can parents find you on Twitter?
You can find me at Extreme Virus Prof, with an X for extreme, of course. Extreme Virus Prof. Mm-hmm. And I'm really active on Twitter, particularly given the current situation.
Yes.
And you can also find me at my website, which is at Portland State University, but it's Extreme Viruses.
Yeah.
Now, E-X-T-R-E-M-E, viruses.org.
Awesome. And I'll make sure that all of your information is included in today's digital daycare newsletter that will go out every single day. So make sure you hop over to thefablab.com to be included on today's newsletter list so you can get the recipe for today's project, all the information to meet with Dr. Ken, the virus hunter, and so many more things.
So what do we need to do now?
We need to wash our hands.
We need to wash our hands.
So I'm going to wash my hands. Dr. Ken's going to wash his hands. And we're going to meet you in the next, and we're going to meet you in the Fab Lab Active Hour. But first, I can't wait for you to meet some Fab Lab kids that have been using their creativity in their isolation to make all kinds of things for us to smile and be inspired by. So I want you to meet my very special friend, DJ Quarantini and Eliana from Portland, Oregon, with this awesome quarantine song.
Bodies, we're gonna set some intentions, we're gonna do some stretching, we're gonna have fun. Now, what's always important to remember right now,
social distancing,
giving each other space.
Yep, lots of space that I
can't
touch.
Even if you're with your brother and your sister, give them a little space because we're gonna move our bodies. Now, things that we need to get started out with, we have a towel to wipe yourself off if you get a little sweaty, and also water. We should be drinking a lot of water every day.
Go grab a water, yes.
Go grab a water if you need some water. So now, what we're gonna do first is we're gonna sit down for 1 second before we start moving our bodies.
Sit down?
We're gonna sit down for 1 second. Come on, Lindsey. All right, let's sit down for 1 second. And I want you to think of a word or a thing or a person that makes you really happy. So close your eyes for a second. Think of a word, a person, a thing that makes you really happy. It could be your dog, it could be your mom. I want you to think about them and then like dedicate this workout to them. Aunt Lindsey, have you picked yours?
I sure have.
Okay, I've picked mine. Hope you all picked yours. Okay, let's get started moving our bodies. Come on back, come back up. All right. Let's start out, let's stretch a little bit. Let's just before we move our bodies out. Okay, so let's spread our feet. All right, bring our arms up. And we're gonna bend our knees and bring our arms down. And come back up. Go back down. And come back up. Two more times. Go back down. And come back up. Go back down. And come back up. Now, can you guys touch your toes? Let's try touching our toes. Ready? Touch your toes, touch your knees. Touch your toes, touch your knees. Touch your toes, touch your knees. Now bring your feet back out wide and just touch the ground. Feel that stretching in your legs? You're gonna use our legs, aren't we?
Yeah.
I feel pretty good. All right. Now, let's bend our legs a little bit. We're gonna come down just like that, like in a runner's lunge, right? Bend a little bit. That was pretty good. Now let's switch. Feet. Feel good? Hope it feels good. All right. I think I'm ready to start moving. Are you ready to start moving?
I'm ready to start moving.
Okay. You guys ready to start dancing? Okay. So our first dance is going to be pretty easy to learn. Ready? Okay. So on to Lindsey, we're going to go to the right and then to the left. We're going to add on, okay? Right, left, right, left, right, left. Okay, we're gonna add on to it. So we're gonna go right, left, front, back. Right, left, front, back. Right, left, front, back. One more time. Right, left, front, back. Now we're gonna add something cool to it, right? So I'm gonna show it to you and then you're gonna do it too, right? So I'll show it to you. Ready? Everybody, one, two, three, watch. Right, left, front, front, back, back, step around. It's a little something, okay? So right, left, front, front, back, back, step around. You wanna try it with me? Here we go. Right, left, front, front, back, back, step around. Here we go. Here we go. Right, left, front, front, back, back, step around. And we're back in spot. One more time. Right, left, front, front, back, back, step around. Ready? Let's add our arms now. Right, left, front, front, back, back, step Turn around. There we go. We keep our arms in two. Ready? Right, left, front, front, back, back, left. You're doing great. Okay. Now we're ready? Now we're gonna move our hips over. There we go. Right? All right, moving. Now, let's add our arms. Just shake your hips. Now, turn around, turn to the side. There we go. Now turn around. And turn around. One more time, there we go. Oh, Lindsey, you're such a good dancer.
I've never heard that in my life.
That was, okay, that was our first song. Okay, we ready for more?
Ready, you guys ready?
Okay, so now the next one we're gonna like rev it up a little bit more, move our bodies. Ready? Okay, so now let's start marching in place. Move those arms. There we go. Are you doing it with us? Are you having fun? Okay, all right, now we're gonna add a little more. Step forward, step back. Step forward, step back. Step forward, step back. Step forward, now lead with the other leg. Forward and back. Forward and back. Forward and back. All right, now let's just hop roll.
I'm really good at hopping.
Are you guys good at hopping?
I wanna see your hop.
How high can you hop? Woo! All right. Okay, ready? Now plant your feet and squat. Right, left, right, left, right, left. Right, left, right, left, right, left, pause. Again, right, left, right, left, right, left, right, left, right, left, right, left, pause. Okay. Ready for some more? Ready to add on?
I'm ready, I'm ready.
Okay, so now, do something a little more fun. We're gonna like, we're gonna get low. All right. Okay, there we go.
I got it.
All right. Now. We're gonna do our feet from side to side. Right, left, right, left, right, left, right, left. Okay, now, gonna face me. We're gonna do our social distancing dance.
Oh!
This is the social distancing dance. You gotta give each other space. Give me space. Sometimes you gotta tell people to give you a little space. You need to run a little bubble. Ready? Okay. Ready? Down. Right, left, right, left, right, left, pause. 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 Okay, now I'm gonna teach you like a dance from when I was a kid.
Okay.
That's when Lindsey was a kid too. We were kids at the same time.
We're all kids.
Okay, so the dance we're gonna learn is called the running man. And Lindsey knows, wait for it. 3, 2, 1, go. You're gonna run into place. Hey. Can you do it in a circle? Uh-oh, my heartbeat is going. Keep going. Other way, in a circle. Hey. All right. Come on, let's burn it up. All right. This is the time to wipe yourself off.
Great time to get a little water.
Have a sip of water. Who likes Lizzo? Do you like Lizzo? I love Lizzo. This is a Lizzo song. All right. Okay. You ready? Now, let's do some work, some movement on the ground. Ready? So we're gonna come down on our hands and knees, right? So now let's just try. We're gonna lift one leg at a time, right on the beat. Wait for it. Sound good?
Yeah, sounds good.
Three, you're gonna start with your left leg.
Okay.
One, two, three. Left leg up, left, right, left, right, left, right, left, right, show it. Left, right, left, right, left, right, left, right. Okay, now we're gonna add on. Can we add our arms in? We got our arms in. So you're gonna do your left leg and your right arm. Let's do it together. Left, right, left, right, left, right, left, right. Okay, show it one more time. Let's show it one more time. There we go. Left, right, left, right, left, right, left, right, left, right. Okay, next up, we're going to come to our feet right here, right down in a squat position, right? How are you feeling? You guys feeling good?
I'm feeling so good right now.
We're gonna come up really slowly, right? Our legs are gonna burn a little bit, but okay, here we go. Come up a little bit. Right there. A little more. Stay. Stay out, Lindsey. A little more.
Are you doing it?
Now come up. Are you doing it too? A little more. Okay, so come up. Over here. Over here. But I think we're going to go back down. Really slow. Ready? All right. Okay, come on. Are you guys ready? Here we go. Just go down 1 8. Down 2 8. Down 3 8. Now halfway. She's sitting down like in a chair. Now if you need to come up on your toes a little bit. There we go. 3 5 8. 6 8. 7 8.
I'm already down.
We're all the way down. Okay, now let's take a plank together. Let's take a plank together. Oh, man, I'm sweating. Are you sweating?
I'm super sweaty.
I'm sweating. Let's take a down dog. Just cuddle your feet out. Now we're doing something really fun. We're gonna hop our feet in. Gonna hop in. All right. Then hop back out. Again. Hop in. Hop out. Hop in. Hop out. Keep going. Hop in. Hop out. Hop in. Hop out. Hop in. Hop out. Hop in. Okay, now walk your hands back to your feet. We're gonna do a little bit of stretching. All right, hands back to your feet. Touch your knees. Touch your toes. Touch your knees. Touch your toes. How are you guys feeling? Are you feeling good?
Woo! If you're
not
tired,
sweating.
We're tired.
We are. We're working here too. All right, so. Like, keep it crazy on Lindsey sweats. I sweat all the time. I'm a sweater. If you're a sweater, that's great. If you're not a sweater, that's great too, but I sweat.
If you're not sweating, you're doing it wrong.
You should be working hard. Towel up. All right. So now we're gonna like, get into like a little more like salsa movement. Does that sound good to you?
Yeah.
All right, okay. So now we're gonna learn a little salsa movement. Ready? So we're gonna go back, forward, back, forward, right, forward, back, forward, a little faster, there we go, raise your hands, oh, and you can put a little shoulder in it, alright, this is fun, okay,
are you having fun?
Okay, now we're gonna do like a little body movement, there we go. In a circle, in a circle, in a circle. You stretching your chest, your back. You should feel pretty good. Now, do you remember what we taught you, that little move that we taught you? That little like, the two?
Yes.
So when the chorus comes back around, we're gonna do it. But this time, we're gonna do it like we're performing for a huge crowd. Like we're gonna put on a show.
For you.
All of you, and you put on a show for us. We can't wait to see it.
When you put on a show for us, make sure you use hashtag digital daycare workout.
Okay, right, back, 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 jazz it up. Back, 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 back. Now, you know what this makes me want to do? This makes me want to do some like lunges. Are we doing some lunges?
I want to do some lunges.
It's time for lunges. Ready? Okay, so now. We're all in one place. We're gonna lunge back. One leg at a time. We're just gonna focus on our left leg. Ready?
Okay.
So let's go back. Back, forward. Back, forward. Back, forward. Back, forward. Switch leg. Back, forward. Back, forward. Back, forward. Back, forward. Now, we're gonna do some ball squats and then wide squats.
Okay.
All right, that's it with you?
Yeah.
Are you feeling good, crazy out
I'm
Lindsey?
Tired.
She's tired, but it's good to get tired sometimes, okay? So ready? So we're gonna go out, in, out, in. Make sure you're squatting. Out, and in. Out, and in. Out, in. Out, in. Out, and in. Now let's just walk in place for a second. Your legs might be burning a little bit. You're a little tingly. That means your legs are working. You're welcome, so we're all getting tingly together. Okay, I feel like I want to stretch my upper body now.
Let's do it.
So let's, we're gonna reach on the other side to the right. We're gonna go right, left, right, left, right, left, right, left. Then we're double up. Right, right, left, left, right, right, left. Put your hips in it. Right, right, left, left, right, right, left, left. Okay. Okay, this is a really fun song. I really like Selena Gomez. Do you like Selena Gomez?
My God,
her songs are so good. Yeah. Okay, so now.
Do you guys like Selena Gomez?
Do you guys like Selena Gomez?
What's your favorite Selena Gomez song? I want to hear about
Tell
it.
Tell us what your favorite song is. I love Come and Get It, but I also love this song. I love a lot of her songs, okay? So if you like her, jump. Okay, you jumping? Having a good time jumping? Now we're gonna jump from side to side. We're gonna start on the right. Ready? Right, left, right, left, right, left, right, left. We're jumping rope. Left,
oh!
Right, left, right, left. Can we do a little faster? Like. Double time. There we go. There we go. There we go. Now right, left, 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 right, left. Okay. Now, next up, we don't want to lose our momentum, our heartbeats up.
Right.
Do you guys like doing jumping jacks? I like doing jumping jacks.
I don't know if I can do another jumping anything.
All right, we're only gonna do 5 jumping jacks.
Okay,
right? You'll do 5?
You can
okay,
do
ready?
5. You can beat Crazy Aunt Lindsey. I wanna hear about it.
All right, so 1, 2, 3, 3, 4, 4, 5. 5, that was good. Nope, you just remember social distancing.
He got okay. It, that one.
All right, so now we're gonna bring our knees up, right? So, right, left, right, left, right, left. You wanna do something really fun? Okay, so we're gonna go kick, then kick out. Kick, then kick out. Kick, kick out. Kick, kick out, other leg. Kick, kick out. Kick, kick out. Kick, kick out. Kick, kick out. All right, let's shake it all out. Shake it all out. Shake it all out. Ooh. Ready for the next dance move? All right, next dance move is also from when I was a kid. And this dance move is called the Cabbage Patch. Do you know the Cabbage Patch?
I think that was this one.
Yeah, so we're gonna do the Cabbage Patch, all right? So 1, you gotta roll your arms around in a circle, like this, and go, 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 go. Put your body through it, go, 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 wait, other way, go, 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 hey, go, 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 go. All right. That was fun one. Okay, now arms are good. I want to do one more with our arms. I'm gonna do a wop. Do you know a wop?
I don't know how to do it yet.
Go 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, harder. 2. There we go. There's the aunt Lindsey. I know. Okay. So now, the next song that we're gonna do is going to be our last movement song. Then we're gonna start stretching and meditating. Cool. And do you remember the thing I told you to think about that you set your intention for? Do you remember what that is? Yeah. Does it make you smile when you think about it?
It does, gives me more energy actually.
I'm really excited.
Yeah.
Okay. So the next song is by somebody named Nathan, and I love too. It's like a fun, fun song.
Okay, cool.
She's all the way from Sweden. Don't call me up. Do you know where Sweden is?
Of course I know. Anyone out there is hanging out in Sweden? Let us know.
Hey, let us know if you're in Sweden.
Workout.
If you've been to Sweden, you can tell us. If you know where Sweden is, tell us where Sweden is. Is Sweden in South America? Is Sweden? Well, you can't give it away. They gotta tell you. They gotta answer back on your page. Like, is Sweden in the U.S.? Is it a state? I don't think so.
All right. Send me a tweet or an email. I want to know.
All right, we're gonna do some body pumps. Don't call me up. I'm going out tonight. Feeling good now, you're out of my life. Don't want to talk about us. Gotta leave it behind. One drink, get out of my mind. And we're gonna turn the back next. Back. And now we're gonna turn to the left.
And I don't
want to
turn to the right.
Yeah, turn to the right. You're right. You're right. Okay. Now, next. Next move we're gonna do is like a foot crossover. So it's gonna be a right and our left. And you can do this as hard or as deep as you want to. Like, you can be up here, or you can go like lower. Hope you guys are having a good time. We're having so much fun here in the Fab Lab living room.
Yes, I'm
just dancing.
Moving your bodies.
I think it's time for a body pump again.
I think so too.
Here we go. In a circle. Don't call me up. I'm going out tonight. Feeling good now, you're out of my life. Don't want to talk about it. Back. Hey. Now put your arms in it. Out, in, out, in, out, in, out. In, out, in, out, in, out, in, to the front, out, in, out, in, out, in. We got this.
We don't know.
We're having fun.
What are we doing? Are we doing it right?
Are we doing it right? Okay. Now.
Mistakes are important, okay, in the Fab Lab.
We all make mistakes.
Not mistakes, it's just fun. They experiment.
Okay. Now, spread your feet. Touch one toe, touch the neck. And the neck. And then next. Now fold on your left and put your right arm up. Stretch a little bit. Yeah, now let's do the other foot. Ready?
Yeah.
Do the other one. Don't call me feeling really good. Stretch. Feels really good. Are you guys feeling really good? I'm in stretch. Okay, now bring your feet together. Right? Step up to the front, to our mat, top of our mat. Touch your knees, touch your toes. Now bend your knees just a little bit. Then bring your hands over your head. Now we're in a mountain pose. How tall are you? I'm really tall. I'm like as tall as a building. Now bring your hands down to heart center. You can close your eyes. And I want you to remember what your intention was. You wanted to dedicate this to. I want you to just think about that for a second. Take a deep breath. Softly exhale. Now take a deep breath and bring your arms up in a big circle. Bring your back, your arms back down. Breathe out to your heart center. We're gonna do that two more times. With a big circle, breathe in. Breathe out to your heart center. One more time. Big circle. Breathe in. Breathe out. So now we're going to work on yoga. Okay? So we're going to bring our arms up. And now we're going to hinge from our waist with our back straight and bend over. So we're going to put our arms up. Your toes, breathe in, touch your knees, touch your toes, breathe out, now place your hands down, and step. So now we're in a plank. Now, you can do this up on your toes, or you can be down on your knees. Both are really effective. So now we're gonna come down halfway. All the way down, all the way down. All right? Now just lift your shoulders, stretch your back a little bit. That feels good.
Come back down, down. And come up one more time
with just your shoulders.
Then you're gonna push back
to a child's pose.
Then get in child and all of us.
We all go to child's pose. Take a deep breath and breathe out. Now we're gonna come back onto our knees. And we're gonna do some cat cow.
Ooh, I love cat cow.
Lindsey loves cat cow. Lindsey has a cat, play.
And cat. No okay. Cows, though.
All right, so. First, we're gonna do our cow, and we're gonna breathe in.
I'll demonstrate.
Show us your best cow. I'm doing it. All right, so you're gonna arch your back, and you're gonna lift your head. Nope, you're gonna go the other way. You're doing your cow. There we go. Now, you're gonna go into your cat, and you're gonna arch your back up high, like a cat that's there. Now arch your back. Breathe in. And breathe out to your cat. Breathe in again. Arch your back. And one more time to your cat. Real high. Now from here, we're going to step our toes back and go into a down dog. You know how to do a down dog? Lindsey, show them how to do a down dog. There we go. Step back, just like Aunt Lindsey. Now, if you're in your down dog, you can pedal your feet. Let's pedal our feet. Pedal your feet. That feels pretty good, yeah? Okay. So now, next up, we're gonna lift the right leg up. And we're gonna step our right leg through. Right now. So right now we're like in a runner's lunge. So what Aunt Lindsey's gonna do is she's gonna put her left hand down flat and she's gonna turn to the right. Reach up. Oh, that feels really good. How do you feel, Aunt Lindsey?
I love this pose.
This is a good pose, yeah? Alright, now we're gonna come back down. And then we're gonna step our foot back. And then we're gonna lift our left leg. Now, Lindsey's gonna put her right hand down flat next to her foot. She's gonna turn to the left. Hope you all are breathing. Breathing's important. And if anything hurts, don't do it. All right, now Lindsey, come back down. And we're gonna step that foot back to another down dog. Let's pedal our feet again. All right. Next, we're gonna do a round of warrior. Does that sound good, Lindsey?
Yeah.
All right. So, what we're gonna do is, just like we just did, we're gonna lift our right foot. I'll show you. Lift the right foot high. We're gonna step it through.
Right foot. Right foot high.
Yep.
Step it through.
Just like that. Now, we're gonna swing our left foot diagonal. Like, or actually, there we go, so like, just like that. And we're gonna come up like this. Nice job, Aunt Lindsey. All right, now Aunt Lindsey, see how little Lindsey is? We're gonna fix the vest a little bit. There we go. All right, so that's good. So, we're gonna hold that. Now, we're gonna do reverse warrior. And now we're going to do side angles where we lean down like this. There we go. All right, back to warrior two. Now we're going to do as a combination. We're We're gonna do reverse warrior, then we're gonna come back down to our hands. So we're gonna go reverse, and then cartwheel our arms down to our feet. And step our foot back. Take a second, catch your breath. Stretch, you can pedal your feet if that feels good. If you need a second to have some water, this is a good time to have some water while we're in down dog. We're gonna ready to do the same thing on the other side. So lift your left leg up high. Step it through. Then you're gonna turn your right foot to support you. And we're gonna come up. Just like that. Let's just hold it for a second. Lindsey, you're doing great. You're so quiet. Have you ever seen Mom Lindsey this quiet? She's focusing.
It's rare.
All right, we're gonna do our reverse warrior. Now come back to warrior two. And we're gonna do an extended sliding. So lean down. If you want, you can look up at your left. Right hand, or you can look down, you can look wherever you feel comfortable, but it helps you keep your balance. Alright, we're going back to warrior two. Remember that combination we did? We did reverse warrior, and then cartwheel your arms down, and step your foot back. Alright. Hands are up, and we're gonna swing them around and bend down like you're sitting in a chair. Put your feet together, or your feet wide if your balance is a little shaky.
We'll see.
You bring your feet together, and then come down into chair pose. The thing about chair pose is you just have to hold it. You just gotta hold it. Try to sit down a little bit lower. There we go. Take a deep breath. Exhale, bring your hands to the heart center, and then dive over and bend down. Now touch your knees, touch your toes, now bend your knees a little bit, stand up, back up to mountain. We're gonna do that one more time. All right, you guys ready to do chair pose? I wanna see your best chair pose yet.
Are you guys sweating?
Are you sweating?
I'm sweating.
I'm having a workout, okay. Now we're gonna go back down to chair pose. Ready? So we're gonna bring our arms around in a big circle, and then we're gonna point them forward. Chair. Oh, you guys are having fun. I'm having a lot of fun. Lindsey, I think you can sit a little lower than that. There we go, see?
Can you go lower too?
Can you go lower? You don't wanna fall over, but you can go a little lower. Bring your hands to heart center. Bend over, touch your toes, touch your knees, touch your toes. Now bend your knees a little bit, stand back up to mountain. Now, we're gonna do a tree.
A tree pose?
We're gonna do a tree pose.
Okay, let me see.
So now there's a few ways to do a tree pose. I'm gonna show Lindsey while we're distancing. Okay, so now, to do a tree pose, you can just put your foot like a kickstand. Right there, right? Just there. Or, so maybe, bring our hands to heart center.
Should I go the same way as you?
Let's bring our hands to heart center, right foot. Or if your balance is really good, you can bring it up to the calf. Now you never want to bring it on your knee. See right there, that's not a good spot.
Why can't you bring it to your knee?
Because you can hurt your knee joint by putting pressure on it. So you don't want to do that. Even if you feel like you can, you shouldn't do it. If your foot should either be below or above. Now, if you can get your hand all, if you get all the way above, that's great. But I think for right now,
I used to be able to do it.
I used to be able to do it too. I can do it sometimes, but I'm gonna do. If you can bring your leg all the way up, then you need to send us a picture of it, because we need to see it. All right, so remember that thing that made you happy, that you thought about, your intention for this exercise? I want you to think about it and try closing your eyes for 2 seconds. Lindsey, you gonna try with me?
I'm already closed.
Well, she's already closed. I'm closed too. Thinking about mine? Okay, open your eyes back up. Were you able to stay up? Did you fall over?
No.
I did pretty good. Did you guys do pretty good? Let's try it one more time. Close your eyes for 2 seconds. 1, 2. All right, let's bring that leg down. That was good.
I can do it.
That was pretty, like, Lindsey, you're pretty cool. Like, for a crazy aunt, you're pretty cool. All right, now let's do the same thing with our left side. So, remember our options. You can just do a kickstand with your foot right up there. And your hands are at heart center. Or you can bring your foot up to your calf, like Aunt Lindsey's doing, or you can bring your foot up really high, but never on your knee joint. You can have it up against your thigh. Let's bring your hands to heart center. Now, if you already know how to do this, and some of you may already know yoga, you can exalt your arms. Do you know how to do that, Aunt Lindsey? Let's see. So by exalting your arms, you can bring them up like tree branches. Can you imagine yourself being a big tree? What kind of tree would you be? I want to be like a cedar. I want to be a cedar.
Ooh, I love cedarwood oil.
I want to be a cedar. What kind of tree would you be, Lindsey?
I would be like one of those pretty, like, weeping, like, willows.
All right, she's a weeping willow, but we need you back in your tree.
You messed me up. I was doing something.
We need you back. We just need you back. All right, so now remember what we did before where we closed our eyes for two seconds.
Okay.
So we're going to get back into our focus, right? Look at me. I'm still holding it together. Barely. If you fall out of it, it's a normal part of it. It's like, we all fall out of it. Let's close our eyes for 2 seconds and think of the thing that makes us so happy.
The Fab Lab is all about trying, not perfection.
There we go. Yeah, losing my balance. All right. Down. Bring our feet down. So, how was it good, Rich? Was your balance pretty good? Hope your balance is pretty good. Hope you had fun doing it. So now we're gonna start to wind ourselves down a bit. So let's go back down to the ground. So how we're gonna do that?
Can we take a second to get the wigglies out a little bit first?
Do you need to get the wigglies out?
I need to get my wigglies out. Do you guys need to get some wigglies out?
All right. So to get the wigglies out,
yes,
you have to close your eyes and you have to wiggle like no one in the universe can see you.
Close
your eyes and wiggle. Boom. All right.
Are your wiggles out?
Are your wiggles out? Okay, so now let's bring our hands back up like a mountain. And we're gonna bring them out to the sides and hinge from the waist, bend down, touch your toes. Touch your knees, touch your toes. Now plant your hands, step your feet. Now you're gonna come down to your knees and we're gonna lay on our backs for a second.
Are we gonna get on our backs
we're
now?
On our backs.
Okay, cool.
We're wind down.
You guys ready to lay down?
You can swing your legs around and you're gonna be sitting right on our bums. We're gonna do a round of bridge and then we're gonna take a rest.
A bridge pose?
We're gonna do a bridge pose. You wanna see what a bridge pose
is? Yeah, I wanna see a bridge pose.
I'll show you a bridge pose. Okay. So, you got your feet about as wide as your hips, mm-hmm. right? And we're gonna lay down, just like this. And to do a bridge, make sure you're like, your fingers can touch the bottoms of your heels. So bring your heels in nice and close. And to do a bridge, you're just gonna lift your hips up. Just lift your hips and hold them. Lower down. We're gonna do that 2 more times. Lift your hips. right foot and bring it over your left knee. And we're gonna thread the needle through our legs like that, just to stretch. You're gonna grab your leg, yep. Grab your left leg right around your shin. Just stretch. How does that feel, Lindsey?
It feels good.
Yeah.
Feel my hip opening.
Yeah, it's a really good hip stretch. Bring your left foot down. Bring your right leg back down. Your left foot over your right leg the same way you just did, and you're gonna thread your arms through your leg around your right shin. And bring your right chin up to get a nice stretch in the left hip. This is our second to last pose of yoga is a freestyle. You can pick any pose you like, you can do it, and then we're gonna go into Savasana. So, my pose that I'm gonna pick is this one.
That's exactly the one I was gonna do.
Yeah, that's the one I want.
What is this called?
It's like a butterfly. Thing. Don't poke. But so you can put one hand on your tummy and one hand on your heart. If you're doing this pose with us. If you're doing another pose, that's great. Now before we go into our final rest, we're going to bring our legs long and our arms long, and we're gonna take a big stretch, like to squeeze everything. So just take a big stretch, stretch in every direction.
Stretch your face,
squeeze, and let go and rest. Whew. Side body, just like this. And we're gonna sit up from there, cross leg. And I just wanna say thank you to everyone who watched this, for tuning into the Fab Lab, for loving crazy Aunt Lindsey. We're hoping that you had a great time with us. And usually when we close yoga, you know what we say? We say namaste.
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 Guys, thank you so much for joining me during activity hour right here in the digital daycare from the Fab Lab. Stay tuned, because we're gonna have lunch next.
Wash your hands, everybody. Wash your hands to the beat. Wash your hands, everybody. Wash your hands with me. First, put put the water on hot.
Hot.
Put some soap on your hands.
On your hands.
Gotta wash your hands a whole lot.
Whole lot.
Keep a clean hands is the plan.
That's plan.
Now rinse them. Give them a shake.
Do the shake.
Dry your hands. I said dry your hands. Wash your hands and don't touch your face.
Finishing up washing my hands. That workout was intense, if I don't say so myself. I have for sure worked up quite an appetite, and I'm so stoked that you're going to join me for my Fab Lab lunch hour. Now, let's see what in the world we have in the Fab Lab lunchbox. I would love to see. Now, some of you out there may recognize this. I did a crowdfunding campaign not too long ago, maybe about a year ago, and we came up with a Fab Lab lunchbox that was a limited edition, super special. If you'd like to have one, maybe I'll make more. Leave a comment, and if you're visiting me on Facebook, leave a comment if you would like to see more of these. If not, don't worry about it. But you can also support this channel when we're not live streaming on Patreon, patreon.com/thefablabhq. Okay, so let's see what's in our Fab Lab lunchbox and what we're going to make for lunch. You ready? I'd love to see a top down. Okay, this is crazy. A banana, a tomato, and two random things just left open. I love it. Let's put these to the side. And I kind of want to think to myself, I think this is my favorite spread ever, pesto, which is just basil and parm cheese and a little olive oil and a very special nut called the pine nut. Have you guys ever heard of pine nuts? If you're allergic to tree nuts, you definitely do not want to have this specific version, but pesto, and this looks like a little hummus that I had left over from my delicious, delicious lunch yesterday from a local, Portland local restaurant called Kebab. The best falafel I've ever had. This hummus is super yummy, but I was so full that I had a little left over. So I'm gonna see if I can turn this into something interesting. Now, I don't think I can just spoon these things into my mouth. Oh, and a tomato. Can't just spoon them into my mouth, so I think what I'm gonna do is find some bread, which I just so happen to have right here, a delicious sourdough. I'd love to know what you guys are having for lunch if you haven't already had lunch. If you haven't eaten yet, now's a good time. So I'm going to take out, two slices of bread. This bread is so soft and smells delicious. Put this away. Okay, so I heard that the link went down. So if you're rejoining us, thank you so much for sticking around. Welcome back. We are still in the Fab Lab lunch hour. I just made a really delicious Fab Lab pesto and hummus sandwich with things that I already had in my refrigerator. Actually, the hummus was left over from lunch yesterday. I'm so stoked. My little tomato fell out when I was showing you how beautiful it was inside. Look at that. I don't know if you can see, but I'm so stoked to eat this. But before I finish, before I go eat my lunch, I'm going to quickly make a little bit of a dessert. I also pulled out of my Fab Lab lunchbox a banana, one of my favorite fruits. When I was a kid, I didn't love bananas. I did not love bananas. And then one day, I just ate them all. So if you don't like bananas, that's totally fine. We'll have tons of fruit every day this week for you to, that might be your favorites or your new favorites. But this is our fruit for today, and I'd love to hear what your favorite fruits are. So I'm gonna open my banana, but I'm gonna show you a little trick. So some people like to open bananas like this. I prefer to open my banana like this so that I have a little handle on the bottom. That's actually how you're supposed to open bananas, but to each their own. I like to have a handle. So I'm peeling my banana like so. So when I'm eating it, it's a sweet little handle. Cool. But we're not gonna just eat it like that. We're gonna dress this up with one of my favorite spices. So here we're gonna put this banana peel here, and I'm gonna really quickly use a butter knife and good kitchen skills, and I'm just gonna slice my banana. Bananas have not a ton of sugar, but they do have quite a bit of sugar. So I'm not gonna eat the whole banana today. I'll save this for later for a smoothie or something. And I'm gonna take my banana pieces and my freshly washed hands. I've been washing my hands so much that they're so dry. You see how dry they are? Lotion is very important right about now. Okay, so I'm gonna take my banana slices and I'm gonna add them to my plate. Maybe I'll do a little, I don't know. Should I do a smiley face? I think I'm gonna do a smiley face. Just a little bit of this. Let's see what we can do. Here, actually, I'm gonna eat this one. It's my lunch, so I can do that. Oh, cute. And then, like I said, we're gonna use something extra special to dress up our bananas. Does anybody know what this is? Cinnamon. This is actually the bark of a tree. Yes, the bark of a tree is what cinnamon is. And we're gonna use a little bit of this to sprinkle onto our bananas. Hopefully it won't just like all dump onto the plate, which happens all the time for me. Ah. Oh, cute. So cute. So cute. Okay, yes. Perfect. So just a little sprinkle of cinnamon on my banana, and that's it, guys. Little banana, a little cinnamon, a beautiful, 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 delicious looking pesto and hummus sandwich that I cannot wait to eat. But while I go eat, and you've probably already had your lunch, what in the world are we gonna do in the Fab Lab? Something very special. Do you remember DJ Passport, Mr. Marceau, from our awesome Fab Lab Active Hour? Well, guess what? He's a really awesome person and has tons of different talents. And one of his most amazing skills is ASL, American Sign Language. He's an expert in it. He's actually an interpreter. So he's gonna come along and he's gonna teach us a few things about that language. But first, we're gonna wash our hands because I just touch all kinds of food and I'm super sticky in my fingers. So I'm gonna rinse my hands and introduce Mr. Marceau right now.
Wash your hands, everybody. Wash your hands to the beat. Wash your hands, everybody. Wash your hands with me. First, put the water on hot.
Hot.
Put some soap on your hands.
On your hands.
Gotta wash your hands a whole lot.
Whole lot.
Keep a clean hands is the plan.
That's plan.
Now rinse them. Give them a shake.
To the shake.
Dry your hands. I said dry your hands. Wash your hands and don't touch your face.
Hey, everybody. Do you remember me? I'm DJ Passport, but my parents call me Marceau. And I'll tell you more about that later, and even how to spell it. But thank you so much for watching the Fab Lab. Give it up for crazy Aunt Lindsey. Now we're gonna learn something about that because like we call Aunt Lindsey crazy, but is she really crazy? Nah, she just gets so excited and happy and it's great. And so we're gonna learn a bit about that and learn some more about how we'd even communicate that. So I'm here for language hour. Like, we're gonna learn some language. So I speak actually technically 4 languages. Did you know that? No, you probably didn't know that because you don't know me, but you're gonna know me. I speak 4 languages. I speak English, which most of us speak. I speak American Sign Language using my hands and my face and my body, because that's the thing about American Sign Language. It requires your whole body. Your face, your hands. It's not just saying things with your hands. You're giving a whole expression. Now, my parents are from Haiti. Do you know where that is? It's in the Caribbean. My parents are from that island. So I speak Haitian Creole. Also, I speak some Spanish. I used to live in the Dominican Republic, but maybe I'll tell you about that some other time. But today, I'm going to share some of my American Sign Language skills with you. How does that sound to you guys? Does it sound good? Maybe some of you have already learned some sign language. Maybe your parents taught you some sign language, some baby signs, and I'm going to teach you some more signs. So to get started, just understanding some things about American Sign Language and why it's so great and it's so special. Did you know that American Sign Language is the third most widely used language in this country? Most people don't even know that, but it really is. Now, did you also know that American Sign Language is just really specific to America? Every country, almost every country, has their own specific sign language, and it's all really different. It's not just one language for all deaf people, but depending on where you live in the world, you see things a different way and you express things in a different way. So Japan has their own sign language, Great Britain has their own sign language, France has their own sign language, Mexico has their own sign language. So there are all kinds of sign languages all over the world. But here in the US, we use American Sign Language. So the next time you see a deaf person, you can actually go over and say hello. So we're gonna learn how to do that today. We're gonna learn some basics in American Sign Language. We're gonna go through the alphabet, and we're also gonna work on some basic greetings, how you say hello and how you introduce yourself and how to be courteous and friendly. But before I get started, I'm gonna wash my hands because one of the most important things that we've learned recently is the importance of washing our hands. Because when you're using American Sign Language, sometimes you have to touch your face. So make sure your hands are really, really clean. So I'm gonna step right over here. I'm gonna wash my hands a little bit. I hope you guys are doing a good job of washing your hands. It's important for our own safety that we're all pitching in by keeping ourselves clean and keeping our hands really clean. All right, now that my hands are clean. So where do we start? So we're gonna start with how you say hello in American Sign Language. You know how you say hello in American Sign Language? Usually maybe in just like regular world, we go like, hi, we may wave, but in American Sign Language, when you say hello, you say, hello. Can you do that with me? Let's do it together. Hello. So anytime you see a deaf person, if you see someone using sign language, you can just look at them and you can say, hello. Now, what's polite to do when you first meet someone? Do you just say hello and then like run away? No, you introduce yourself. So I'm gonna teach you how to introduce yourself. So you'd start out by saying hello, then you would say my, me. So you put your hand right on your chest. That means me, my name, right? Now, do you guys know how to spell your name? Maybe some of you already know how to spell your name. So let's go through the alphabet and then we'll work on spelling our names. So in American Sign Language, okay, now I'm gonna need you guys' participation to do this with me. So anyone who's watching, I need you up. I need you doing this with me. We're doing this together. A, you see that? See my hand? A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H, I, J, K, L, M, N, O, P, Q, R, S, T, U, V, W, X. See that? X, Y, Z. Did you get that? Should we do that one more time? Let's do it one more time. And remember, pay keen attention for the letters that are in your name, because you're gonna practice spelling your own name. So let's go from A again. A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H, I, J, K, L, M, N, O, P, Q, R, S, T, T-U-V-W-X, see that? X-Y-Z. So, now I'm going to introduce myself to you. Hello, my name is M-A-R-C-E-A-U. Now, something really special happens when you meet a deaf person is they give you a name in sign language. So every time you say your name or someone calls your name, they don't have to like spell it every time. You have a sign language name. My sign language name is this. It means like excited, enthusiastic, ready to go, because that's what my personality is like. So if I was introducing myself to someone, I'd say, hi, my name is M-A-R-C-E-A-U. Now, what's your name? Can you spell your name? Go ahead and spell it. Good job. Like, so if your name was Kevin, how about I spell out Kevin for you? K-E-V-I-N. If your name is Ashley, I'll spell that for you. A-S-H-L-E-Y. If your name is Bree, B-R-I. If your name is Preston, P-R-E-S-T-O-N, it's really important to be able to introduce yourself. So, now that we know how to spell, we know how to say hello, how would we have like a really simple, basic conversation? Just ask someone, how are you doing? I'm doing good. I'm doing fine. So, now that we've got, let's put it all together. We have, hello, my name is Marceau. What's your name? So that's how you sign what. What's your name? Now, if you wanted to say, how are you doing? There's two different ways that you could say it. You could say it in a really literal way, and a deaf person would understand you. How, this is how you sign how. Make your two fists like this. How are you? Just how are you, right? Or you could ask a deaf person, if you could just look at them, you could go like, hey, this is this for feeling. How are you feeling? How are you feeling? Right? There's multiple ways to ask, but you could say, hello, my name is Marceau. How are you? Now, what are responses that you would say to how are you? Most common response in American Sign Language is to say, I'm fine. That's how you sign fine. Now, if you wanted to say that you were better than fine, you were doing really good. Do you want to know what that looks like? Okay, I'm going to show you what that looks like. So you could say, I'm fine, or you would say, that. Look at that. That means I'm like doing great. But what if you aren't doing so great? What if you're just so-so? You could say so-so. Or you could say I'm tired. You could say I'm happy. You could say, oh, I'm actually sleepy. But there's a variety of things that you could say when someone asks you, how are you doing? So now, Do we get all that? Can we put that all together? I want to know, and I want to hear in the comments how you sign. And please send videos to the Fab Lab of you using your newly learned sign language. And if you already knew sign language, that's great. I hope you learn even more. It's really important to prioritize being able to communicate with other people, even if they speak a different language. It's important to communicate with one another. So, now, what's something else that we could learn in sign language? Do you already know how to count in American Sign Language? All right, let's practice counting in American Sign Language. Now, counting in American Sign Language is really interesting because it's not what you would think. You would think you just do your fingers the same way, 1, 2, 10, but it's, to count in American Sign Language, you only have to use one hand. You could count to 1,000 before you would have to use a second hand to count. So let's just go through 1 through 20. Let's practice that. We're gonna start with 1 through 10, and we'll work our way all the way to 20. So we have 1, 2. Now, how do you think that you sign 3? Is it like this? No. When you sign 3, you go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Now, this gets a little tricky. 6, see that? See how my thumb and my pinky meet? That's 6. 7. 8, 9, 10. Did you guys get that? Should we try that again? Like one more time? What do you think? We'll try it one more time. So let's count. I'm gonna do it with both hands. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine, ten. That was pretty easy, right? Let's see, can we go all the way to 20? All right, so I'm gonna do 1 through 10. Hopefully you're doing this with me. You got your hands up, ready to sign. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Now, we're gonna go up to 11. 11, 12, 13, 14, 15. Let's try that one more time. 11, 12, 13, 14, 15. Now, ready to go up to 20? 16, 17, 18, 19, 20. We just counted to 20 in American Sign Language. I hope that you're able to do this with me. Let's start from 1 and we're gonna go all the way to 20. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20. We've just been able to count up to 20. So if you couldn't count to 20 before, now you know how to count to 20. That's really exciting. So let's review the things that we've learned so far. We've learned quite a few things. We've learned how to spell in American Sign Language. Hopefully we've learned how to spell our own names in American Sign Language. We also know how to say hello in American Sign Language. We know how to say, how are you? We know how to respond to that. We can have a pretty simple, basic sign language conversation. So let's go through what we've learned so far. Our ABCs. A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H, I, J, K, L, M, N, O, P, Q, R, S, T, U, V, W, X, Y, Z. And how do we count to 20? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20. What else did we learn today? We learned how to say hello. Okay. Hello, my name is Marceau. Question for all of you Fab Lab watchers. What's your name in American Sign Language? Do you know how to spell it? I hope you do know how to spell it by now. Now, that was pretty fun and that got us like started with learning American Sign Language, but next up, I want to teach Aunt Lindsey a little bit of sign language. I wonder how you say her name in American Sign Language. So Aunt Lindsey's going to join us for a little bit, and I'm going to teach her a little sign language and even how you say crazy Aunt Lindsey in American Sign Language. Hey, Aunt Lindsey. Thanks for coming here. Listen, we got to remember social distancing.
Social distancing.
We're going to give each other some space. Okay, now, some people think when you say crazy Aunt Lindsey,
right.
What does that mean to you? Does that mean like you're crazy, you're cuckoo, you're going to be...
No, thank you so much for asking that. I get that question all of the time. Why do you call yourself crazy? And this is the thing. If you look at the dictionary, crazy has two definitions.
Two.
Maybe, I think also three, but two main ones.
Maybe three.
The first one, yes, is someone who's not fully in their mind, someone that's a little bit
loony,
you know, which some of those people do exist, and that's okay because we're all a little kooky sometimes. But the second definition of crazy is extremely enthusiastic. And that is the crazy that I identify most with. So when I had, when I was a childcare provider 10 years ago, and I was teaching kids how to do things like, you know, use Play-Doh to make models of cells and crossing the street like a duck to make sure everything we were crossing the street safely, I would hear all the time, oh, Aunt Lindsey, you're so crazy. You're so crazy, Aunt Lindsey. So it just stuck. It's not that I am not fully in my mind. It's that I am just so excited about what's in my mind that it just can't, it doesn't have anything to do but come out. So okay. Enthusiasm.
So now let's learn, how would we sign that? Like, because those are two really different thoughts. Like someone being crazy, like in their mind, and someone being like really excited. Remember when I said my sign language name was this? It means like someone that's really excited. That's like Aunt Lindsey too. She gets so excited. Now Aunt Lindsey, can you work with us on spelling your name in American Sign Language?
Gosh.
Can we do this together?
I didn't see the whole first part, so you're gonna have to show me.
Oh, okay. I can't wait to teach you. I can't wait to teach you. That is a C.
I can start.
Sue sees it. Okay, so let's start with Lindsey.
Okay.
Do we remember how to do an L? L.
Oh, this is super intuitive.
I. Now N, I'm going to show you an N. That's an N with two fingers. N, D, looks shaped like a D. S, make like a fist.
It's like stop.
Stop. E.
E.
Y.
Y.
That's it.
Cowabunga, dude.
Hang 10. Let's try that one more time for everyone.
Sure, sure. Okay.
Let's do it again. L.
L.
I.
N,
D,
S,
S,
E,
E,
Y.
Y. All right, can you do this one on your own? Like, just try it on your own. I'll help you if you need help, but I think, like, Alexi has this. She can totally do this. Okay, all right,
okay, sure, okay.
All right, so let's start with
social distancing.
Social distancing, social distancing.
Social distancing, social distancing, social distancing. Yeah. Okay. L, I, N, D,
yes, very good.
S-E-Y.
And how do we sign excited again? Excited! Thank you, Aunt Lindsey, for coming in.
Coming.
And just doing that part. Remember, she's not this kind of crazy. She's this kind of crazy. She gets so excited.
I love the time.
Like she does spin. Like,
all the time.
Do you remember during the active hour? Like, she knows how to spin. She's fun. Thanks for coming out. I just wanted to have help with that part.
How do you say thank you?
No.
Oh, that's the only part?
That was the only part. We just wanted to have you spell your name because everyone's learning.
I would love to learn how to say thank you, though.
She wants to know how to say thank you. Should we teach her how to say thank you?
Did you guys learn already?
No, we haven't learned that yet. Have we also learned? Now, that's a really good thing to learn. Mm-hmm. Now, it's important for all of us.
Is it like this?
No, no,
is
no.
Is it like this?
No. With this stuff. It's important for all of us, no matter what, to show good manners.
Yeah.
Saying things like please,
yes,
thank you, mm-hmm, good.
Yeah.
We're gonna learn those type of signs. You ready?
I would love to know thank you so that I can go set up for story time.
Oh.
Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah. Thanks for joining.
Do you know story time's coming up next? Okay, story time's coming up. So I hope you guys are gonna hang on and watch with us. Yeah. Thank you so much for watching. Now, the way that you say thank you. You put your hand, remember we washed our hands, right? So our hands are clean. Mm-hmm. You put your hand right here on your chin. And now thank you, what's interesting about thank you is it's a directional sign. So you direct it toward whomever you want to say thank you
gratitude
to. So if I want to say thank you to Aunt Lindsey, I would say thank you.
Thank you.
Now, if I wanted to say thank you to all of you, I want to say a big thank you. So I'm going to use both of my hands and say thank you.
I love it. Thank you. You can stick around and teach them how to say wash your hands.
Yes.
If you haven't done that already.
Oh, we're definitely going to teach that.
I go set up for story time.
Yes. Story time is coming up next. Thank you,
Aunt
Lindsey, for coming on. Okay. So a few more signs before we wrap up our language lesson for today. We know how to say thank you. How do you think you say please? I'm going to show you. Please. That's how you say please. Now, how do you say good? Like someone did a good job. Good. See that? Good. How do you say something is wonderful? Wonderful. It's important to be able to express praise and say something was wonderful. Now, Aunt Lindsey just had lunch. Do you think that lunch tastes good? Yeah, I think it totally tastes good. You know how you say something tastes good? delicious. Delicious. Aunt Lindsay's lunch was delicious. So next up, I'm gonna wash my hands as we wrap up. Thank you so much for watching. Now remember, it's so important for us to stay sanitary and clean all the time. No matter what's going on, we should always wash our hands. So I'm gonna wash my hands and then we're gonna get into story time with Aunt Lindsay. Are you guys ready for that? Are you ready for story time? Okay, I'm gonna get over here and wash my hands.
Wash your hands, everybody. Wash your hands to the beat. Wash your hands, everybody. Wash your hands with me. First, put the water on hot.
Hot.
Put some soap on your hands.
On your hands.
Gotta wash your hands a whole lot.
Whole lot.
Keep a clean hands is the plan.
That's plan.
Now rinse them. Give them a shake.
To the shake.
Dry your hands. I said dry your hands. Wash your hands and don't touch your face.
Welcome back, guys. And thank you, DJ Passport, for doing that awesome lesson. I am so excited about all the languages we're going to learn in the coming days and weeks ahead. Now it's time for story time here in the digital daycare. We're going to do story time a little bit differently. One of my favorite new magazines that I just discovered is called Kazoo. It's an awesome activity magazine that comes out, I think, like two or three times a year, but it is just full of all kinds of activities, and most of them are STEM and learning related. It makes learning so fun. It's got games, activities, puzzles, but one of my favorite things is that in every single episode, every single issue, they share a story. And I read this one recently, and I just thought I'd like to share it with all of you. This one is called City Girl by Karina Yan Glaser. I thought the illustrations were really beautiful. And like I said, the story itself was pretty great. And so I'm gonna read it out loud to all of you guys. Is that okay? So if you're ready for story time, grab a snack, maybe a pillow, hop up on the couch, and let's start reading. City Girl by Karina Yan Glaser. Everyone in the car is singing except for me. Mama's at the wheel, warbling loudly, while my dad taps out the song's rhythm with his knuckles against the front passenger window. My big brother Sam doesn't know the words to most of the songs, but that doesn't stop him from making his own lyrics. Even Popcorn, our mutt that looks like a cross between a dachshund and a bulldog, howls along with the low notes. I slouch in my seat, wishing I had not forgotten my headphones in the mad rush to get out the door this morning. The tiny Honda that my parents had rented for our vacation chugs along toward Maine, taking us further and further away from my beloved apartment in New York City. My family calls me Cindy the City Girl. I lived in New York City all 8 years of my life, and I love everything about it. I love getting places by subway and bus. I love people watching. I love my neighborhood. I love that my neighborhood has tiny restaurants that sell food from all over the world, like spongy injera bread from Ethiopia, Mexican tamales with pork and masa steamed in corn husks, and plump Tibetan momo dumplings served with salty broth. Sam is my opposite. He's 2 years older than me and loves reading books about trees and insects and geology. It was his idea that we visit Acadia National Park in Maine for spring break. I had requested Washington, D.C., where we could visit museums and monuments, or Chicago, where we could take a boat tour of all the beautiful buildings in the Chicago River. But Sam looked so hopeful, and we had only visited one national park before in our lives, so I gave in. I have regretted it ever since. I am not a fan of insects. I get creeped out when it gets too dark, and sleeping in tents feels very unsafe. I like our apartment, where we have two deadbolts and a chain lock on our door. Gotham Mountain sounds cool, says Sam, engrossed in his Acadia guidebook. Along the trail are ancient sea caves that were created when the sea levels were about 250 feet higher than it is today. Prehistoric fish used to swim here. I turn away from my brother and open my copy of Anne of Green Gables. But reading makes me a little carsick. So I arrange my blanket to create a little nest around my body, and I close my eyes. At my feet, Popcorn rests his head on my sneakers. The steady hum of the car engine, my parents singing, and even the sound of my brother reading the pages of his guidebook eventually lull me to sleep. "Wake up, sleepyhead," my brother says, pushing my head off his lap. I must have tipped over and fallen onto him when I was asleep, which is unfortunate. I check to make sure that I didn't drop silly putty or a cracker crumb into my hair like he's done before. Nothing feels out of place, so I touch the spot on my face between my nose and my mouth. I can't feel any marker, but that doesn't mean that he didn't draw a mustache on me when I was asleep. "Is there anything on my face?" I ask my dad. But he's too distracted, looking at the campground office to help me out. "There it is," he says, pointing. My mom parks. "I'll be right back," she says, jumping out of the car and disappearing into the office. She reappears a moment later with a handful of maps and a parking pass that she hangs on a rearview window. We jolt over a rocky, unpaved road toward our campsite. Popcorn roughs with every bump. The trees form a tunnel around us, and I immediately wonder what Anne Shirley from Anne of Green Gables would think about this place. Would she call this path the tree tunnel of evergreen delights? Sam rolls his window down and sticks out his head. I can't believe how happy he is. "I see our campsite," he shouts. I peer out the window and spot a bare patch of earth with a fire pit and a picnic table. "We're staying here all week?" I ask. No one answers me. The second mom parks the car, Sam opens the door and bolts outside. Popcorn jumps out after him, and I watch them explore the fire pit as if it was an archaeological site. The ground is damp and muddy. Insects buzz all around. Mama and Papa start unloading. I don't want to leave the safety of my nest. I wonder if anyone will mind if I stay here in the car for the rest of the week. I close my eyes and think calm, happy thoughts, wondering if I can transport myself back to New York City by wishing hard enough. A knock on the car window jolts me from my daydream. I open the door, but I don't get out. "Wanna come watch your dad and brother try to put up a tent? They're gonna be hilarious," Mom says. I shake my head. I wanna go home. I don't like insects and dirt. I don't want to sleep outside. What if a bear crashes into our tent and eats us? Mom gives me a nudge, and I slide into the middle of the seat. She sits down and puts her arm around my shoulder. "You know," Mom says, "when I feel uncomfortable in a new place, I try to think about characters in a book. I try to think about characters in a book who have loved it. It helps me to see this place with new eyes. I thought about Anne of Green Gables when we were driving toward the campsite," I admit. "Anne would probably think that this is a beautiful, magical place." Mama agrees. and about how the Omiyakas from the other book you were reading, The Birch Bark House, and I smile. She would make friends with all of the forest animals. Mama takes my hand. Are you ready to come out? We were thinking of taking a hike and then coming back here for dinner and s'mores. Marshmallows are one of my favorite foods. So I give in, and together we head towards my dad and brother. The tent is collapsed on top of them, and Popcorn is barking wildly. I can't help it. They look so funny, I start to laugh. After Mama and I get the tent back up, we head to the Gorham Mountain. Sam's guidebook says the trail is only about 2 miles long. My brother carries a bulging backpack filled with maps, binoculars, water, a camera, and a field guide, a multi-tool, 7 granola bars, and a notebook. I thought this was a short hike, I asked him, eyeing his backpack. He tightens his shoulder straps and even buckles the waist belt, something he would never do in New York City. It's good to be prepared. You never know what will happen. I shrug and follow him. The trail is quiet, so different from home. In our neighborhood, you can't walk for 1 minute without bumping into at least 5 people you know. I take a breath and try to see the mountain as Omiyaka would. She lived back in the 1850s, when America was filled with trees and animals. Thinking about her living peacefully in the forest and being with friends with all the creatures gives me some comfort. Sam runs ahead, and then he gives a yell of excitement. Sea caves! Sea caves! Cindy, come look! He disappears behind a pile of rocks. Be careful, Mama and Papa call out at exactly the same time. When I get into the spot where Sam has disappeared, I realize that the rocks create a set of caves that you can lower yourself into. I kneel down and peer into the darkness, but Sam is nowhere to be found. His voice rings out from inside the cave. Cindy, you have to see this. It's so cool. No, thank you, I say. Papa takes a seat on a smooth rock. I'm not going down there. There's no way I'd fit in those little crevices, he says. Mama agrees and takes a seat next to him. I'm looking for my own rock to sit on when I hear Sam's panicked voice. I'm stuck! Mama and Papa spring up and rush to the opening of the cave. Are you okay? I'm fine, but my backpack, it's got a snag or something, and I can't move, yells out Sam. Can you slip the backpack off? Mama asks. It's really narrow down here. I can't even move my arms. Can you come help me? Papa tries to lower himself into the cave and then stops midway. I'll get stuck if I go any further, he says. We need help. Mama takes out a pocket flashlight and shines it into the cave. I peer down and then look around me, expecting someone to magically appear on the trail who can rescue my brother. I'll try the ranger station, Papa says. He pulls out his phone, but there's no reception. My parents exchange a look, then they glance up. The sun is beginning to set. We don't have much time left before night falls. And I know what I have, we don't have much time before night falls, and I know what I have to do. I'll go into the cave, I tell my parents. I don't know, Mama says, her eyes really worried. I don't want both of you to get stuck down there. We can't come after you. I can do it, I insist. And after a brief pause, my parents agree. Mama hands me the flashlight, and I close my eyes and channel Anne and Omiyaka. I'm coming, I yell down to my brother, and slip down into the cave. It's very, very dark, and my sneakers sink into the mud. Sam, where are you? I call out. Over here, he says. Be careful. I point the flashlight in the direction of his voice. As I walk, I steady myself against the sidewall with my other hand. The rocks are cool and rough against my fingers. Just when I don't think I can go any further, I turn my head and catch a glimpse of movement. It's Sam! Oh, thank goodness, Sam says. I don't want to spend any more time out here. Sam is pinned between two rocks. I carefully undo the shoulder and waist straps of his backpack. The straps are undone, I tell him. Can you squeeze out? Sam slides to one side, and he is free. The elastic bungees of his backpack are tangled up on a tree branch, growing against the rock outcrop. Is everything okay? Mom asks from the crevice above. Yes, we're fine, Sam calls out as he rescues his backpack. We're coming out now. I touch his arm. Hey, did prehistoric fish actually swim down here? And Sam's face breaks into a wide smile. They did. Do you want to go explore? I look around and I imagine gigantic, scaly fish weaving in between the rocks. I look at my brother. Yes. Sam grabs a flashlight and sets his backpack down. We don't want to get stuck again. And we check out of the cave for 10 more. I can't believe these rocks used to be the ocean. When we reemerge, Mama and Papa and Popcorn are anxiously waiting for us. My parents fold me into a hug, and together we head back toward our campsite. I skip down the trail, calling out to my brother when I see an unexpected animal print in the mud or a bird's nest perched high in the trees. I discover that I actually like jumping off tall rocks. It feels as if I'm flying. That night, after we have our fill of roasted marshmallows, Sam invites me to pull my sleeping bag outside the tent so that we can sleep under the stars together. I surprise myself by agreeing to it. The night is clear and the sky is full of twinkling stars above us. In the city, there's so much light pollution from the thousands of streetlights that it never really gets dark enough to see the stars. Usually, when I think I see a star, it turns out to be an airplane wing or a strobe. I snugged into my sleeping bag, my brother on one side, Popcorn on the other. How amazing that this same sky smiled down on those prehistoric fish all those millions of years ago. I may be a city girl, but today made me realize that I can also love new and different things. I think about all the places in the world that exist under these very stars, places that might surprise and delight me. I promise myself that one day I will go out and explore them all. One of my favorite things about this magazine are the little messages in the back of it. And I just think it's perfect for today. Not only is it beautifully designed, but it's a really great message. I Am Not Afraid by Cheryl Strayhand. I say that because we're all sharing a really, really scary time. Our parents are working from home all of a sudden, or maybe lost their jobs. News has a lot of scary information, but I just want to remind you that just because something is scary doesn't mean we have to be scared. Sometimes we can tap into bravery and try something new and adapt. And maybe we'll find out that on the other side is something really great. I hope that's true for all of you. I thank you so much for joining me today. Thank you for joining me today. I can't wait to see you tomorrow with more Fab Lab Digital Daycare. Thanks for watching.